Hello, are you ready to discover the 11 essential factors that can make or break your instructional design career transition? If so, then stick around until the end of our episode today because I am going to be unveiling all 11 factors that you should be considering. All right. So as I mentioned before, we're going to be talking about the 11 essential factors that can help you with a seamless career transition into instructional design. So I do want to just start out with letting you know that if you are a teacher, I was in a very similar space as you several years ago. I was a fifth grade social studies and science teacher from Greenville, Texas. I went through a life change that drove me to look for other careers. But at the time, I didn't even know that instructional design was a thing. What I knew was that I wanted out of the classroom. And I literally went to Indeed.com or Monster Jobs. I can't remember which one it was. And I looked at every single job in my area going, yes, I can do that. No, I can't do that. Or I'm missing those skills, or I'd have to go back to school for that. Until I finally landed on a job at Texas A&M University Commerce that was in the space of L&D. I didn't know what instructional design was, but whenever I was looking at that job posting, I was like, oh, I do that as a teacher. Oh, I do that as a teacher. Oh, I don't do that as a teacher, but I could figure out how to do that. So I was in a very similar situation. So what I'm going to do today is share some information with you about the things that I learned along the way from my own personal experience, but also from working with teachers inside of our Instructional Design and Tech Accelerator program who are working on their ID certificate, as well as the students that I do one-on-one coaching with who are looking to make that career transition. So these 11 factors that I'm about to share with you are from both personal experience and professional experience. So number one, the first thing that you should do is consider, what is your why? Why are you making this transition into instructional design? You know, what are your motivations? Really reflect on that, because you don't want to just go from a career that you don't love into another career that you don't love. So it is really worthwhile to take some time to consider what's taking you out of the classroom, what is driving you towards an instructional design, and then think about what your long-term career goals are and make sure that those goals, that vision that you have for yourself, that lifestyle that you're looking for really aligns with a career in instructional design. So that will go a long way in helping you decide, is instructional design really for you? And to help you even, we're going to talk about it in just a second, but it can even help you think about which path within instructional design you actually want to go down. So number two, who is your support team? You know, life is easier whenever you have a team of support behind you. So it is worth it to think about, all right, so I know for sure that I want to make this career transition. Who's there to support you? You know, is it, you know, your spouse is going to help get the kids to school or get them up in the morning so that you can work on developing your new skills in instructional design? Is it that you are leveraging existing connections that you already know who are working in the field? You're asking people to serve as a mentor to you to help with your development. So it could be related to your actual development and finding a support team of people that are already doing this thing that you want to do. Or it could even be in your personal life, you know, asking your mother or your mother-in-law or, you know, your sister, your brother to watch the kids. If you have kids, watch the dog. If you have a really loud dog, like some of us do, but asking them to help take care of some part of your life so that you can dedicate some time to working on your development, whether that's taking online courses, reading books, you know, just getting the tools and starting to practice. It is really a good idea to have a support team that can help you make space for studying. And again, if you can find someone that's in the L&D space to serve as a mentor or coach, even better, because you'll really love that kind of feedback that you can get. Number three, is a career transition really worth it to you? I know that this sounds crazy to even consider this. Like if you know you want out of the classroom and you're pretty sure that instructional design is right for you, you've also got to consider those financial considerations. You know, if you are in a job today and you are making a lot of money, you know, maybe you've been in the classroom for 25 years and your compensation is really high. It is worth it to do a financial assessment of what your current salary is and what the salary of an entry-level instructional designer would be for your area. And you can go to places like Glassdoor or salary.com and look up that information. You don't want to put yourself in a situation where you are leaving the classroom for whatever reasons that you have and then going into a career that might not pay you as much. Instructional design positions typically pay pretty well, typically pay better than our teaching salaries, but that's not always the case. And then even within instructional design, there are certain areas or certain sectors of the field that pay differently. So it's important to know what kind of instructional designer you want to be, what setting you want to work in, and then look at that entry level salary. And even though you personally may not be an entry-level career professional, as a new instructional designer entering the field, you will most likely go into an entry-level position. So those are all things for you to think about and to assess whether this transition into this field is really worth it based on where you are in your career today. All right. So again, always good to think about those things. Number four, what type of instructional designer do you want to be? So I've already said that we would talk about settings and roles, and here we are. This is exactly where we are landing right now. So as an instructional designer, you can work in different sectors of the field, right? You can work in corporate, you can work in higher ed, you can be a freelancer, you can work in not-for-profit, you can work in ed tech. And in all of those different domains or sectors, you will see differences in compensation. So it's worth it to look at those. So maybe you go to salary.com and look up, what does an entry-level instructional designer make in higher ed? What do they make in corporate? What do they make in ed tech, right? So really look at those things, because this will also help you answer number three, is it really worth it? And then think about the type of instructional designer you want to be. Every company designs the task of instructional design a little bit different. So it could be that you do just straight instructional design, where you are writing the content, you're creating the learning experience, you're writing the engagement exercises, you're creating the assessment questions, you're creating group discussions and finding the scenarios and crafting the learning experience around that. Or you can be an instructional designer that does all of that, plus the e-learning development, plus the instructional video builds, right? It really depends on the organization. And then in some cases, you know, you might also be the LMS administrator and the facilitator. So it's really important that you identify, you know, which parts of instructional design really resonate for you, and then go out and look at jobs and see what you can find on LinkedIn or Google or wherever, and then go back and look at those salaries too, right? Because that might influence which sector you want to work in and what type of instructional designer that you want to be. Number five, what transferable skills do you have? And if you've been here in our Hangout community for any length of time, then you'll probably remember that we recently did an accelerated ID episode on which teacher skills you can leverage immediately in a career in instructional design. So that is always very important to think about, you know, like, what's your starting point? What are your gaps? You know, what can you leverage? So go ahead and take a look at those. And if you want a more in-depth analysis of this, go back and watch that video. Sarah and Gabriella will drop this into the chat for you, into the comments, so that you have this information and you can go back and watch this video. But you know, as a quick summary, I'm not going to get into all the details here. As a teacher making this transition into instructional design, you have transferable skills in the area of project planning, communication, collaboration. You use technology on a daily basis. You have facilitation skills. And of course, you have curriculum development skills. So these are all skills that you can leverage. So this gives you a really strong foundation Obviously, there will be gaps that you don't have. You know, there is a difference between teaching and instructional design. But as a teacher, it's almost like you've got a head start over other people that are making this transition into this career, because you already do some of these things, but now we just got to add into that skill set. So go back and look at that video, take a snapshot of the screen and have this information. Really, you'll want to focus on, like, what are the other skills that you have to develop in order to make this transition. All right. So number six, how can you get reskilled? Well, the good news is that there are several ways that you can get reskilled. There's not one perfect way. So it's really going to depend on how fast you want to make that transition. How much money do you want to spend? What kind of time investment do you want to put into this? So whenever you're thinking about how you can get reskilled, option one, you could do self-study. There are so many resources out there, right? There are groups like here in the Hangout where we put on live trainings every single week. You can plug into these videos every week. If you miss them, you can go out to our YouTube channel, catch the replay. We have a blog. We have free resources, but we're not the only people out there that's doing that. You can follow other people in our space. You can check out books. You can, in some cases, download free books. You can check out other people's YouTube videos, right? There are a lot of free study options out there. So obviously, when you do the self-study and you're relying on free or almost free resources, this is the most economical way to do this. The challenge is, you might not know which path to go down, or it could take you, you know, an elongated period of time because you're having to figure it out as you go, but definitely an option. And it's a good option for many people. Step two, you can plug into a certificate program or enroll in Academy. ATD has a certificate program. Many influencers out there in the instructional design space have certificate programs or academies. We have one. We have our Instructional Design and Tech Accelerator program, which I'll tell you about here in just a second. So there are many options for you. There is also a master's degree. You can pursue that, right? If you've got a couple of years time to work on this, maybe you're not ready to make that transition out of the classroom right now. Maybe you're willing to do it in 2 years or 3 years or however long it takes you to get through the program and then apply. And, you know, this one is one of the more pricey options, right? So you can get into a master's degree anywhere from 15,000 to 30 plus, depending on where you want to get your master's degree. And then, of course, my shameless plug about our Instructional Design and Tech Accelerator Certificate Program. So this one does give you ATD education credits. You'll get a certificate. We'll take you through all the foundational components of instructional design. We'll teach you how to use the technology, Storyline 360, Rise 360, Adobe Premiere Pro, PowerPoint. And of course, we'll wrap all that up and help you build a portfolio and help you get your resume together and prep you with interview questions. If you have any questions about this program, you can DM Sarah, Gabriella, me, or Katie, or just ask for the link in the comments and we'll make sure that you get those. All right. No matter which option that you choose, you do want to make sure that you are plugging into a program that is paying attention to the latest trends, you know, and what's current. So let's say you go down a master's degree program. You want to make sure, you know, like, what's the AI component in that? You know, have they already updated their curriculum? If you're doing self-study, in this case, you might want to work with a mentor or a coach and ask them for suggestions on where to start. But always make sure that you're looking at what's current and what's trending so that whenever you do get yourself ready to go out and do interviews, you can talk about those things and have some experience with that. Number seven, how can you showcase your skills as an instructional designer? I think it's pretty well known that you need a portfolio. You definitely do. You want it to be sharp. You want it to be professional. You want it to demonstrate the skills for the type of job that you want to pursue. So it's definitely worth spending some time developing this portfolio. And again, back when we talked about your support team, this would be a really great place for you to have your mentor. If you choose to work with a mentor, look at your portfolio, look at your work so that you're always putting your best foot forward. if you can't find a mentor, you know, reach out to someone in our Hangout community. Ask someone here. Our community has, you know, aspiring instructional designers like many of you that are watching now. It has new instructional designers, and we have many experienced instructional designers in this group. So it could be a really great place for you to source a mentor. And if you can't find one, know that we actually have coaches who do one-on-one coaching and instructional design, e-learning and portfolio, and even in getting hired, we have a career, coach who is a certified resume specialist and career coach. Number eight, how can you find jobs? So this is always a big question. So how do I get an ID job, right? Well, this is the same in any career field. This is not specific to instructional design. This is true for everybody. LinkedIn is a really great resource. It's free to you. You can always upgrade to a premium account, which will show you how well you stack up against the competition, but that you don't have to do that. I like it because it allows you to have inboxing credits, and it will tell you, like, on a scale of 10, you know, where do you rank for this job based on your skill sets? Because it's looking at your profile. Google is a great place to look for jobs. Indeed is a great place to look for jobs. In your network, and then continuing to grow and expand your network by, you know, going to different instructional design events. You know, ATD puts on things, the e-learning guild puts on different things. So plugging into these organizations and these conferences and events, that's a great way for you to network and expand your network. And then again, professional organizations like ATD. With ATD, you can join your local chapter, which is far more affordable than joining the national membership. So the national membership costs quite a bit, but definitely worth it. I would have your employer pay for that whenever you get hired as an instructional designer. And then in the meantime, join your local chapter. I want to say that in most areas, it's less than $100 per year. So it's super cost effective and a great way for you to get plugged in. Plus, these local chapters put on continuing education events. Every single month, there is something in most of the chapters, or at least that's been my experience. So it's a great way for you to grow your skills and grow your network and find potential jobs. Number nine, how can you elevate your status as an instructional designer? So you want to make sure that you are super familiar with the industry. You know who the influencers are in the industry. Know what the new research is coming out. Again, this, I don't mean for this to sound like an ATD commercial, but ATD is the world's largest talent and development organization. So they are a really great place for you to find out what's trending. They put out different reports periodically. So that's just a really great place. And again, you can get a lot of information through your local chapter. And then, you know, do your own research, follow blogs, follow newsletters of people that are in the space, you know, join in our weekly sessions, because we like to talk about what's trending and educate you in the space of instructional design. 10, how do you boost your career opportunities? So again, this goes back to that networking, right? So you can boost your career opportunities by expanding your circle of friends, your professional circle of friends. You know, let everybody that you know that you're actually making this transition into instructional design. Email your past employers, email the people, you know, in the different organizations that you work for, just say, hey, this is what I'm doing. Here's my portfolio. If you hear of any opportunities, please let me know. And then just continue to build connections. And then we've got number 11. What is your plan, right? I love this quote by Lewis Carroll. If you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there, right? So if you do know that you are for sure that you want to be an instructional designer, create a game plan for that. How are you going to get reskilled? What are the tools that you need to become proficient in? What does your resume need to say? What do you need in your portfolio? Lay all that out in a plan, put due dates next to all these different things, and then start working that plan, right? That is how you're going to make this transition into instructional design as seamless and as smooth as possible. All right, so let's just do this quick recap of our 11 essential factors that can help you have a seamless transition into instructional design. Know your why, identify who's in your support team, decide if it's worth it, pick the ID sector that you want to work in and the type of instructional designer you want to be, know what skills you have, what skills you still need to develop, make a plan for how you will get reskilled from teacher to instructional designer, build your portfolio. I know this isn't here, but have your mentor, your coach look at it. Look for jobs everywhere, Indeed, LinkedIn, your network, professional organizations that you're a part of, and then work to elevate your status in instructional design, boost your career opportunities by expanding your circle, and then create a plan and then work that plan. And then just as a reminder, if you are interested in learning more about the teacher skills that you can leverage for a career in instructional design, go and check out our YouTube video on those skills, because we break it down category by category, letting you know which skills you have as a teacher and what are some of the skills that might be missing. So check that out.